Can somebody name for me the sports where they put up a white flag? Or I think in boxing, they put up a white towel. Is there any other sport or occasion where it's just too much and they say, surrender, enough is enough, and they put a sign up or something? Because I'm amazed that Jim Jordan hasn't thought of some level of quitting, as in, he's done. How many times has he had a hearing where basically he's had it, well, he's been used as a mop to wipe the floor with his own fault? Because really, the guy doesn't appear to know the difference between facts, truth and BS. In fact, he appears to be languishing fully in the land of BS. And when someone like Dan Goldman comes along, fireworks.
Gentleman from New York is recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Bishop, I'm happy to write you a poem. If you like.
I can't wait.
But, you know, I want to go back to something you say, which is some memo or whatever, that all we want to do is talk about Donald Trump. The fact of the matter is that this committee, which may go down as one of the most useless and worthless subcommittees ever created by Congress, is called the weaponization of the federal government. And the reason we all know now that this was created and stood up is that the Republicans are trying to flip the script and to distract from the fact that the true weaponization of the federal government, with evidence and facts and support, was done by Donald Trump and his administration, and will be done by Donald Trump and any future administration. Now, this also goes back to 2016, and the fact that Special Counsel Robert Mueller, the unanimous opinion of the intelligence community, pretty much everyone who looked at this concluded that Russia used false information on social media to interfere in our 2016 election. And the problem the Republicans want to rebut and undermine and distract from is that they did so to help Republican candidate. And so if you attack the Democrats as the real weaponizers of the federal government, then you get to flip the script and turn it on the Democrats and say, oh no, they are, and get to continue doing and opening up the avenues for additional real weaponization of the federal government. Now, Mr. Lukianoff, do you think there is a First Amendment right to distribute deepfakes online?
Is there a First Amendment right to distribute deepfakes online? Of course there is.
Okay. Now, do you think that there is a First Amendment right to distribute deepfakes online with the intent to interfere in an election?
If you add additional steps to it, it can potentially be criminal.
We need to
sure, write. But to create them,
so
and distribute them.
I'm not even going to waste our time getting into this, because what you have just highlighted and agreed to is that this is a very difficult issue. The balance between the First Amendment and what is free speech and
but
what is
respectively, Congressman,
hold on,
you don't
seem
to be taking it
question,
seriously
sir.
At all.
Sir, I didn't ask a question.
You said this was a useless hearing.
I didn't ask you a question, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to reclaim my time.
The gentleman has the time.
That the problem that we are facing in the post-2016 world, where social media is used as a weapon to interfere in elections from foreign governments, is that this is a difficult thing to navigate. That balancing the First Amendment, which all Democrats support, but the First Amendment is not absolute. There's obviously some speech that is not protected. And balancing the interests of free and fair elections is a complicated situation. What is not complicated is, and by the way, this has been the theme of this committee for the whole year. I believe the committee has interviewed more than 30 witnesses, and every single witness behind closed doors has said that the government has never coerced, pressured, or threatened any social media company into taking any action. The whole premise of this theory falls apart. What we should be focusing on is Chairman Jordan abusing the power of his committee in the Congress to subpoena state prosecutors in an effort to undermine their prosecutions of his revered friend Donald Trump. That is no place for Congress to be, no place for the committee to be. That is a true weaponization of the federal government. And when we start talking about other things that are the real weaponization of the federal government, such as Donald Trump's statements that he will just indict his political enemies, or that he would use the Insurrection Act to deploy the military against civil protesters, or even that he had argued his lawyers, one of whom has appeared twice here, is one of our favorite witnesses, John Sauer, actually said that if Donald Trump ordered SEAL Team 6 to assassinate a political rival, it could not be a crime unless he was impeached. Somehow that is a predicate. The fact of the matter is the true weaponization, the threat of weaponization, is from Donald Trump and the Republicans, and we ought to move on from this charade. I yield back.
Gentleman yields back. Gentleman from Florida. With that, I recognize the gentleman from California.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for setting up my question. You're quite correct. The government does have awesome power if it tends to use it in an inappropriate way. We've already heard today the direct quotes of the former president and wannabe president, Mr. Trump, that he would use the government to suppress speech, which presumably is what you were arguing for, free speech. He said very clearly that he would do so. In fact, he's reportedly planning to use the Insurrection Act, a law that gives the president nearly unchecked power to use military as a domestic police force to target those who publicly protest against him, presumably using their free speech rights in the Constitution. Much of this seems to be coming from an organization here in Washington, a think tank, that's put together a program called Project 2025, which essentially would use executive orders that would deploy the military domestically using the Insurrection Act. Ambassador Eisen, a while ago, you wanted to talk about the Insurrection Act and how it might be used by the former and wannabe president once again. Could you speak to that and the trouble that the Insurrection Act could bring to free speech here in America?
Thanks, Mr. Garamendi. The Insurrection Act, as members on both sides of the aisle know, was enacted in 1792 and grants the president the authority to deploy the U.S. military domestically and use it against Americans under certain conditions. It's the primary exception to the Posse Comitatus Act, under which federal military forces are generally banned from participating because of the danger, because it betrays that core American idea that we won't use our military against our own people on our own soil. Unfortunately, the Insurrection Act does not contain definitions of key terms like insurrection, rebellion, domestic violence. Put aside the imminent danger of a president formerly in the White House, who's seeking to return to the White House, who has made the kind of alarming statements. Irrespective of party, it should be an absolute imperative to modernize and update and limit the utilization of this dangerous statutory tool. But it's particularly urgent given the threats that the former president has made. And when you put those threats in context of what people who say these things have done around the world, and indeed who have said these kinds of things, they mean them. So I think it is important, urgent. If there's one thing, if I could ask my friends on the other side of the aisle, if there's just one thing we could do that we could agree on, Americans, and it goes fundamentally to conservative principles about limiting government and the danger of government and the power of executive overreach, please update, limit, confine, constrain the Insurrection Act. Bring it back into accord with fundamental American principles. Thanks, Mr. Garamendi.
Much to be said about this entire subject of free speech, the use of AI. It seems to me that if I were a consumer product company and someone were to put forward disinformation on the internet about my product, would I want to be able to have information from MIT about how I might respond? I think I probably would. And so the issue of the scientific use of information so that I might counter. But I want to stay with the former president, who clearly has laid out an agenda to deprive all of us of our constitutional rights, the Insurrection Act specifically, and more than that. So if it's the weaponization of government that we're interested in discussing here, we have to be aware of what is imminent. A presidential candidate that has put in the public record, in his own speeches, that he intends to limit our civil liberties.
Gentlemen, you'll back.